does that even mean, Bowers Game Corner?
Ahoy there, YouTube! I'm back again today for another game review and a special Kickstarter review. Today I'm very excited to be talking about Castle Dukes from Medieval Lords. This is for 1-4 players, taking about 60 minutes to play, and it's for ages 12 and up. And this is a 1-hour strategy dexterity game. Yeah, that doesn't really go together normally, in which you are going to be building up a castle. And there's a dexterity element where you're going to be trying to make sure this castle will be able to stand on its own and potentially have to deal with dragon attacks. And that's mostly what you'd get out of a dexterity game. But no, this one is also a strategy game, as you really have to focus on what different rooms you're going to put in your castle, how many pillars you're going to put on your castle, where you put the pillars, when you get coffers, do you go for attack, do you go for defense, do you go for leisure, because all the while you're going to be trying to lure kings and princesses and knights to your castle. There's a lot going on in this game. I do want to warn you, the middle part is a little bit loopy, but trust me, it's actually a really simple game. So let's open it up, check it out, and I'll tell you what I think about it. Alrighty then, we're going to take a look at what you're going to get inside of Castle Dukes. So first and foremost, we're going to get a handy-dandy rule booklet. It is, I believe, 14 pages, double-sided, full color, full of pictures, illustrations, examples, and it is thorough. With that being said, when we first read it, we thought the game was much more complex than it actually is, but it is very thorough, and it should have you up and running once you've read the rules. And in actuality, there's only 3 phases that you're going to be doing on your turn, so it is a very simple game. So in Castle Dukes, you are going to have your little plot of land down here, which is where, oh, that's the first player marker, where you are going to be building your castle. So you'll have 3 different spots where you can build your castle. You'll be able to connect bridges and get ballistas and get, you know, flaming cauldron pots. You're going to have to deal with dragons, which will be coming. You're going to be trying to woo princesses and knights and kings to come to your castle in order to get victory points and attack. And in the end, it's really a large scale dexterity game where you're going to be building a big castle and trying to keep that from falling over or having dragons destroy it. We'll go over the components and then we'll get into the gameplay. So first and foremost, let's take a look at the board. Lots of useful stuff on the board. It doesn't look very useful to you now, but over here it will tell you all the different ways you're going to be able to score victory points at the end of the game. Over here it's going to tell you about all the different items and the bonuses they will give you throughout the game. And over here it will tell you how you can spend your 5 actions points, because every round except for the first round, which you know, the second player will have an extra action point and so on and so forth, you're gonna have 5 action points to spend. Now there's a couple things you can spend your action points on, and which that kind of leads me into the room phase, which we'll go into. And this is where you're going to be spending a large chunk of your action points. These are rooms that you are going to be able to put into your castle, into the various different rooms in these tiles, which we'll talk a little bit about later. You can buy the cheapest one down at the bottom for only 1 action point. However, as you spend more money, you're going to be able to gain these black cubes here, which will get you victory points, and these guys right here, which are coffers, which will also get you victory points. And if you spend 5 victory points, if you spend all your action points, then you can buy this one up here, which will give you a table, and the table is super duper nice, because that will give you defense, and it will also give you leisure, which are bonus modifiers you'll be able to put on your castle. Also, this has the turn track on here, which will let you know for the first 3 rounds, you're just going to be building your castle. Nothing bad is going to happen. However, once you get to round number 4, there's the potential that dragons are going to be destroying your stuff. And on round 7, also dragons are going to come back. And then on round 9, they could potentially attack you as well. Last but not least, we have the dragon damage chart round here, which will tell you how many dragon tiles you are going to draw based on what your offense or defense is. So it's very important to kind of focus on one very hard. So for instance, if you have 0-4 attack or 0-6 defense, you're going to be drawing 4 tiles, 4 dragon tiles out of the bag, which is really bad. I'll show you why in a second. So over here, we have the Dragon Bag of Death, which is where you're going to be drawing these tiles when the dragon attacks. And these will tell you to destroy various different parts of your castle. And this is one of the huge elements of dexterity in this game, but I'll show you a little bit more of that later. So that's where you're going to be purchasing rooms over here, spending your action points in order to gain coffers and surf meeples. That's what they're called. The surf meeples are the little black ones. They're going to give you victory points. So
Let's get down to the nuts and bolts of the game, though. So once you've done the room phase and you've purchased rooms and whatnot, you're going to be able to go to the building phase. And this is where you are going to be able to construct your building and also purchase these big tiles over here. They cost one action point apiece, but these are going to be the floors of your castle. So let's go ahead and say I purchased these two on my first turn. So let's show you how this thing looks. So in this middle spot right here, it is not coincidental that that is room for a card. So this is where you could put a room into your castle, which means we would immediately give ourselves 3 attack on this little tracker. Well, not this big tracker right here, which I'll show you a little bit later. So that might be something that I would do. Also, you can go ahead and purchase the pillars. 2 pillars is going to cost you one of your action points. Now, pillars in this game are very interesting. You only have to put pillars on the spots that look like this, that have this red outline. These are called cobblestone. And this tells me that you have to have 2 pillars on here, one over here, and one over there. Now, if you so choose to make it a little bit more stable, you could purchase more pillars, and maybe put one right over here. As long as you are not putting it onto a room, you're fine. So yeah, we might want to do it like that. Now you also notice that this one has 2 spots for pillars as well, and it has these 2 little black things over here. You're like, what are these black things? These are bridge connectors, because yes, as you start to construct up your castle over here and over here, you will eventually be able to connect the two via a bridge. And when you do the bridge, it's going to be able to give you a lot of points, and also well, it's going to give you points, and it's also going to unlock these guys right here, because once you get to the top of your thing, once you decide, all right, this is tall enough, and you build a roof on top of your castle, you're going to be able to put this up, which obviously is definitely going to be increasing your defense and potentially your offense if you can equip other things to the top of this. I don't know exactly what it's called, but it's going to go on the top of your roof. So actually, let's build one up so you can see exactly how that would work. I have to put one right here. I have to put one right there. We got another floor, so we'll do it like this. Oh my goodness, that's very difficult. Heck, maybe we even bought a card right here, so we'll put that card right on top of there. Oh, that's... So as you can see, a lot of dexterity in this game, and then I gotta go ahead and build one over here as well. And we're gonna kind of break the rules on this one. I'm just gonna put a bunch of pillars so you can see how it looks in action. So put the pillars. I think I put some of the pillars on the wrong way, but that's no big deal. So put that right there. Oh, that's a double roomer. That's a great one. That one's going to give you 2 rooms. Now, you also notice that there's a third spot down here. And this third spot down here is a really good spot, which I would recommend, and they even recommend it in the rule booklet, to build another small... Oh, God. So that would be bad news right there. Because I take a collapse penalty. A collapse penalty means you're going to get one of these things right here, which will be -2 victory points at the end of the game, which kind of stinks. The only good thing about it is you're allowed to reconstruct your building at this point and, you know, make it exactly how you want to make it. So let's go ahead and build this up real quick. But like I was mentioning, down at the bottom over here, you will be able to build a smaller castle. And they recommend doing that because when the dragon comes and he attacks you, he's going to start destroying some of your things. Like, he might make you pull pillars out. And pulling pillars out is generally not what you want to do, especially when you've worked hard to make it so that it's not going to fall. So hopefully, let's see if we... Oh, I've been putting a lot of these pillars the wrong way. Let's see if we can get this bridge going across so you can get a feel for how the game really does look once you're in, like, say, round 7, 8, 9, and you got things going. So we've got this up. Oh, is this going to fall over? This is going to fall over. Don't fall over. Don't fall over. Don't fall over. So I flip it to this side to let it to show that this is, in fact, a bridge. There we go. So there we would go. I might also want to continue putting stuff on top of here, but now I've got myself a bridge that is going to go across. So once I have a bridge, I can put this guy on here, and then eventually what I can do is I can start earning the trebuchets and other things which are going to really help my offense. Now, one of the important rules is you can pick this up and put these on there, but How do you earn those things? Well, one of the other things you can do with your action points is you'll be able to purchase these cards right here. And these cards will give you these guys down here, which is how you get those. They'll also give you the trebuchets, the boiling cauldrons, the light. But these are essentially going to just buy you victory points. And if you get to this phase, I highly recommend buying these. These are really helpful. Also, they're going to increase your attack and defense, because I kind of got off sidetrack building this pretty little building here. But once you eventually do get to phase 4, you're going to get to what's called the guest phase. And on the guest phase, once everyone has done building their thing, you're going to roll the dice up, and it's going to show you one person, either a king that wants to come to somebody's castle, a knight, or a princess that wants to come to your castle. And whoever has the highest numbers on these trackers right here is going to earn that person. If there's a tie, then nobody gets it. So the knight obviously wants to go to the place that's more powerful, and he's going to give you more attack, so the rich get richer on the attack. The king is going to want to go to the most safe place that has the most shields, because obviously he wants to be safe. And that one's just flat victory points you'll get, which is always awesome. And then over here, the leisure, that's where the princess goes, and the princess will give you victory points, but also, you can sacrifice her to take less damage when the dragon comes. So let's talk about how the dragon works. So on turns number 4 and number 7, the dragon just automatically appears, and you have to deal with the dragon. So however much defense or offense you have, and you can decide which statistic you want to use, is going to impact how many bad cubes or bad dragon tiles you're going to have to draw. So let's just pretend that I have really focused on offense and I have 8 offense. You know, maybe I got a knight this past turn and I'm really feeling good. So I only have to draw 2 of these cubes. So how this works is you draw 2 of them, and then whatever order you want to, you're going to deal with 2 of them. So I have to lose 2 decor. Now, decor is not just this thing. Even though that's what shows in the picture, decor is actually a lot of different things that you can potentially remove. Tables, coffers, braziers, boiling cauldrons, battlements, ballistas. Most likely, you're going to want to remove the easier stuff to get, like the coffers before you remove anything else. But sometimes you won't have a choice. Now, there also are some really, really bad ones in here. Like, for instance, the one that make you remove, 2 of these guys, which is precisely why you would want to have an extra thing set up over here, potentially even with a couple of these on it, so you can easily remove those without having to suffer the 2 penalty, the 2 victory point penalty you take when that happens right there. Now, it sounds like there's a lot going on in this game. When you first read the rules, it really will sound like there's a lot going on in this game. But I assure you, it really is as simple as just getting your 5 victory point, or getting your 5 action points, purchasing various different rooms right here, then going to the building phase, purchasing building tiles, and purchasing these little guys right here, and then building up your perfect castle, making it strong, making it reinforced, keeping track of your attack, your defense, and your leisure on this little guy, and then eventually dealing with dragons and kings and princesses and knights who are all trying to come to your castle, all of them with good intentions except for the dragon who wants to destroy you. So you'll go over 9 rounds. The 9th round, I believe if you roll a 5 or a 6 in a 2-player game or something else in a 3 and 4-player game, then you'll deal with a final dragon attack. If there's not a final dragon attack, you will tally up your victory points, which will actually be pretty easy because you can look at all the stuff that's on your board right here. Whoever has the most victory points will be the winner of Castle Dukes. And that, in a nutshell, is how the game is played.
Alrighty then, Castle Dukes from Medieval Lords coming to a Kickstarter near you very, very soon. What are my final thoughts? Let's go over the pros. Let's go over the cons. First, on the con side, game's not going to be for everybody for a couple different reasons. 1 to 4 players, a little bit of a restricted player count. Also, I cannot comment on the solo version of the game. I'm excited to try it out, but he did not have the cards in the game to play the solo version of the game. Now, before we get into some more of the cons, I want to break the fourth wall a little bit here and talk about how I personally do things on my channel, which is when I do Kickstarter videos, if it's a preview, that means I generally do not like / recommend the game. I almost gave this game a preview, not because I dislike the game, as you'll find out when I talk more in the pros, but because I feel like this is going to be an incredibly niche game. It combines dexterity and strategy, which a lot of games do, but they sacrifice one or the other. This game tries not to do that. And as a result, it can be very unforgiving, which some people are really not going to like. If you're one of those people who just wants to build and you want to have a cool-looking castle and not get the thing destroyed, this one might not be for you, because when that dragon comes, he really comes, and he comes hard. But if you can get past that, I really do enjoy this game, but let's get back to the con. So moving on to the con side, rule booklet could be a little bit better. I'd like a couple more pictures here or there. And when you're first reading the rule booklet, it's like, what? What is all this stuff? I have no idea what's going on. And then you'll get to a certain point where it'll just click and you'll be like, oh, this game's super simple. Action phase, get the rooms. Building phase, get the stuff to build the buildings, then build the buildings, and then if it's past round 4, try to attract princesses, knights, and kings, and then deal with a dragon on round 4, 7, and potentially 9. And that's really all there is to this game. But learning this game when you're the first person to learn the game at the game group can be a little bit more difficult than I would like it to be. I feel like the rules could have been a little bit clearer. I don't know how, but I wish they would have been. Also, this game can be ruined by just a bump to the table, which is always a con, especially with the dexterity game, but especially so with this one. That will absolutely just send the game down, and then you're just going to have like a 4 or 5 minute period where everyone has to put back up their pieces. Another con that I have with this game is that the dragon just feels... The dragon is a jerk. Like, he is a big jerk, and I just wish he was less of a jerk. Now, I understand that's part of the strategy. They wanted to emphasize the strategy that you need to be planning for the dragon. If you do not plan for the dragon, you will lose the game, and I can appreciate that, but still, come on, Dominic, that dragon's a freaking jerk. He just comes in, and he ruins your pillars, and then he makes you take these -2 tokens. And I don't like that, but it is part of the game. I can deal with that. Any other cons that I have with the game? I wish your player board was a little bit more spruced up. You know, it's supposed to be a kingdom. So maybe you had like a market scene down here. I think that'd be cool. You have little peasants walking around. Maybe a guy in stockings. Not, you know, in like a erotic sort of way, but like the stockings where you put your heads in and your arm in. I think that'd be cool. I think that would add to the thematic flair of the game. Any other cons I have with the game? Oh, it takes up a lot of table space, especially when playing with 4 players, because you're going to have 4 of these big boards right here for everybody. You're going to have all the stuff in the middle. You're going to want to have your own personal space for your inventory and whatnot. So it is a little bit of a table hog at the higher player counts. I want to get all the cons out of the way, because there are a lot, and I feel like this game is definitely not going to be for a lot of people. But moving on to the pros, I really enjoy this game. I love when game designers go out on a limb and they try something different and it works, and this one definitely is that. This is something different. I don't think I've ever played a game like this, even remotely close to like this. This game is a hardcore dexterity game where it's already difficult enough just to build these freaking castles, but then to have to deal with the dragon and then putting things into your castle, like, oh, I can put a knight, but I have to put him right here on the second floor because that's the only space that will take him. Because I didn't even mention this middle part because there's a lot of stuff to talk about, but only certain rooms can accommodate various different people and tables and whatnot. The dragon comes and he just kind of wrecks everything up, and that is a little bit random, and some people are not going to like that randomness. Like, if you draw 2 tiles and both of them are just to destroy, you know, to destroy like your coffers and your tables and whatnot, that's not that big of a deal. But if it's like, oh, I'm going to be losing 3 pillars, that becomes a big deal. And that's one thing that I will mention. If you're teaching this game, if you're watching this video after it's already out and you're teaching the game, they mentioned the rules, and I think it really should be highlighted in the rules, like big, bold, glowing text to make sure that you build down in that bottom third spot just so you can destroy that spot when the dragon comes. But continuing on with the pros, I like what this game does. It's difficult. It's unforgiving at certain points, but it's rewarding. You're rewarded with this really cool looking castle. And that's one thing I love about this game. It really does look awesome when you get done, especially if you have like the bridge and you have the battlement and you have, you know, things hooked up to your battlement. You got princesses over here and serfs over here, And it looks really cool and has tons of table appeal. Like, people see this game in mid-game, they're intrigued. You're going to be laughing a lot during this game sometimes, you know, because you're just so frustrated with your castle falling down. But sometimes you're laughing at other people. Sometimes you're laughing at your misfortune of the dragon. But it is a humorous game. It's a little long for what it is, but I still really enjoy this one. They went out in left field and they found bagels. I don't think that's an expression. I like the game. That's what I'm trying to say. It's different. It's new. It's unique. And if you can get past the fact that they didn't sacrifice dexterity or strategy. So this is a difficult dexterity game and this is a difficult strategy game mushed together. And I think you're really going to enjoy this game. I'm very excited to see what the solo brings, because I think if it has well done solo, then this will be a really cool game. Like, I would love to see a solo version of this game where maybe if you played more than 9 rounds and you just kept building up these bigger castles and castles. But overall, Castle Dukes, completely different. Completely enjoyable, not for everybody, but one that I do recommend you check out if it looks like it might be for you. If you enjoyed this review, please be sure to click on that subscribe button down below in the comments below. Let me know, if you were the king of the castle, what would your kingdom be called? I feel like it's pretty obvious, but I guess I'd have to call it Bower's Game Corner, right? I mean, just one corner of the castle is nothing but games. It's just a giant game library. And yeah, all the people who commit crimes, they have to stay in Bower's Game Corner and play games with me for, you know, like 6 months of playing games. And you must be ready for Twilight Imperium at a moment's notice. Like, yeah, that sounds so depressing. I do have friends. They play games with me. I swear, I really do. But let me know in the comments below, what would be the name of your kingdom? And as always, thanks for your time, YouTube.